Rick? What's that? Hey, go ahead. I didn't think you guys were going to ask me anything about the quarterbacks.
Maybe specifically about the split reps. Did it work as efficiently as it wanted?
Yes, it did. You know, and the reason I did that was, you know, it just felt like you take four quarterbacks and you split the reps up and trying to, you know, the four reps and then they're out, you know, three reps and then they're out. They just don't ever get a chance to get in a rhythm. And this whole thing, this deal in spring practice, was to find out who the best quarterback is. And the only way is you just got to let them play quarterback. And that means go on 9-play drives, 10-play, stay in there, have 15 plays in a row, let them get comfortable, because you know how nervous I'm sure they were, take their first reps in scrimmage. And you want to get them comfortable, and then you're going to see who they are as best as you can until you get them in a real game. So the only way we could do that is to, like, just have only two quarterbacks getting the team and Skelly reps in one day.
Does it have to be a point where, like, 50% in, 75% in practices, really have to give maybe two, three quarterbacks more reps than the rest?
Yeah, you're hoping that they're, you know, you're going to be able to kind of, like, they'll start separating a little bit. And, yes, you're going to have to kind of start getting towards where you ultimately want to have a two-man race, you know. And that's what we're trying to get to at some point in time.
Is there a minimum amount of time that you will go with this structure?
Well, you know, we said we would do it for a week, so we'll do it again Friday, Saturday, and then we'll reconvene on Sunday and talk about what we need to go from there.
Rob, I heard yesterday after you recruited Ethan and got a commitment from a couple of the quarterbacks, you called Ethan and said, hey, we'll come up and, you know, kind of reaffirm your commitment to him, and he said, don't worry
oh,
about
yes,
it.
Oh, yes, yes, yes.
Can you relay that story?
Yeah, I know exactly what you're talking about. So, you know, it's pretty customary for the head coach to go and, you know, you take a home visit in a kid's home, and, you know, it's just customary to always do that. Well, with the early signing period now, which is a little different, it's hard to get in everybody's home, and usually the committed guys, you try to get in their homes maybe, you know, January or August, because, you know, they're been committed for a long time. Well, we're at bowl game, or going to the bowl game, and I said, Ethan, man, I don't know if we're going to be able to get to your house before signing day, but we can get to it afterwards or whatever, or maybe squeeze it in. Maybe we can leave the bowl game and go. He said, Coach, what are you talking about? He said, I'm coming to ASU. I don't care if you come into my house or not. You guys need to go win that bowl game. And maybe I should have taken his advice, but don't write that. but I thought that was really interesting. He did not care whether we, you know, came over to his house. He wasn't interested that Herm Edwards made an appearance at his house. All he wanted to do was watch us win, and that was all he was concerned about.
What does that tell you about him that after he was the first to commit, you then got committed to other guys that he
started? Well, Joey actually was.
Joey was the first.
Yeah.
Same day though.
It was like, a couple days apart, okay. Something like that, about a week or something.
But then he stuck with you guys when he knew there was going to be a lot of competition.
Yes, and, you know, if you ask all three of those guys, I think one of the reasons that they trusted us is we kept constant, clear communication. We told them the truth. There was never a time where we were like, oh, man, what are we going to do? Do you think if he finds out? Well, they didn't have to find out through the media because we told them everything that was going to happen. We told them how it was going to – and we just said, hey, here it is. We hope you stay. We love you. We want you. You know we do. But I'm going to tell you the truth and then go from there. And, you know, it just says a lot about their character and the trust that they have in Herm and myself and the coaching staff.
What's it like when this year it's a new quarterback, but so many other pieces are returning?
Yes.
Whereas last year you were here the whole thing, you had an experienced quarterback.
Right, exactly. So, yeah, so that's a good question because last year I was more of, okay, we're going to stay in the same formation because all the skill guys, you know, they got to move around and they're new and all that stuff, and we didn't want them to have to think and just they run the ball plays. And Manny was experienced, all right, so we could put more plays in but out of the same formation. And I don't know if you've noticed out there, now we put the same play in, but we put it out of a bunch of different, you know, formation. So now you got Kyle Williams, Frank, Brandon, Jordan Porter. They already know, and they're pretty good at getting in all kinds of different formations. But now for the new quarterbacks, I don't have a lot of plays in. I just have like about three. And so now they don't have to worry about it. It just looks different, you know, we dress it up and make it look different for the defense a little bit. So that's the big difference this spring.
How much more important is this time now to kind of get these guys on the same page right now? Like you said, who's going to start separating?
Oh, yeah. I mean, here's what you want to have happen. I'm not saying that it's going to happen, but in a perfect world, you want to name a starter about 2 weeks before, unless he's a returner guy like Manny was. You want to name a starter in a quarterback race. You want to name a starter 2 weeks before the first game. That's a perfect world because then everybody knows he doesn't have to go in the last week worrying about all the questions, all that stuff, and he's just locked in on preparation for 2 weeks right before the first ball game. So in a perfect world, that's what we're hoping to accomplish. And that with this time right here is to try to narrow that thing down to get to that point where we can have a two-man race, then name a quarterback. Now, I was part of Louisiana Tech when we played. We were opening up with Texas A&M. They had a three-quarterback race going on. They didn't name Johnny Manziel, who ended up winning the Heisman, until 1 week it might have been Monday before the game. So, you know, and that works too. So, you know what I'm saying? So hopefully what the plan is what I just described. Hopefully that works out, and it may not. It may not. So.
One last question about Ethan. He's a phenomenal athlete from everything you hear.
Yes.
He's played, he played slot receiver a little bit in high school. Have you had any conversation with him
No.
Point where you don't want to have those conversations?
Right. I haven't said anything, and I'm not even, like, going down that road yet until we have to, and that goes with everybody. Oh, absolutely. Yeah. Yeah, you wait and see because – and honestly, guys, I mean, this happens in the NFL. You're not going to know how good the guy is until you get in that first football game against somebody else in front of those stands. Now, we can make a really good educated guess based upon our scrimmages, but we all know some guys just do it or they don't, you know. So what was the question? I lost myself in talking.
Given the inexperience of all the quarterbacks, would you expect even if you pick somebody 2 weeks before the season that that's still going to be a fluid situation?
Oh, yeah. We always want to be a situation where they have to compete, but it's a fine line. You don't want the guy looking over his shoulder all the time. We don't want a guy where he throws one pick and he's getting jerked out of the game. We don't want to create that situation at all in a perfect world. You know, and I've been a part of several quarterback changes in the middle of the season, and it's a progression. It doesn't ever happen off, and it shouldn't ever happen off one player, one game. It should be leading. We already knew. We knew going into this that was one of his weaknesses. And then just like, you know, you look at Clemson, they made a long-term decision, you know, and saying, oh, okay, this guy, he may not be here. He was here, but 8 games will he be here? And so you can make decisions in that regard as well.
Demetrius Flowers is here now. He's going to catch a couple passes. What does he add to that running back group?
He's a bigger body that can run. He's athletic, and he can come in and pound. And, you know, that's what we always thought about him and A.J. Carter. And we got a pretty good 1-2 punch with a, you know, kind of a thunder lightning type deal. And you got the little man Isaiah, who is really quick. Paul Lucas, both of those guys are very fast, very elusive. And then you got two big guys, AJ and Demetrius. And you know, that's what you want. You want to be able to have like two or three guys that are just kind of different, and they present a different problem to the defense.
James got a really thin frame. Worry about him absorbing hits and being able to deal with it.
No, I don't. Yeah, you always worry about that. If I didn't go through the process with Jared Goff, then I would be really concerned, because I remember looking at Jared and just going, that guy's going to get broken half this year. He's never going to make it through the season. And he never got knocked out of a game until the last game of the season against Stanford. And he wasn't quite that, but it was close. It was close. Absolutely. And so what that does, and when we recruited him, we told him that. Say, listen, we got an offensive line coming back. We got a running game. We got receivers. you're not going to have to come in and you know, be the savior. You're not going to have to do that. You just need to manage the game until you get comfortable, hand the ball off, throw this, throw that, like, just, you know, you don't have to be all world, all right? Just manage the game, and then eventually that guy will get comfortable and he'll become a good quarterback. Yeah, you know, and it's really tough with when you don't have shoulder pads on as an offensive lineman, because you rely on you know, just like, man, those guys just like, you get a rusher, those guys are just used to getting out in front of people and just taking the blow and absorbing it. And right now, you know, it's kind of hard. You know, it's just tough, and you're worried about shoulders, so you're not really throwing shoulders in and different things and all that stuff. So it's really kind of hard to tell. I have noticed some guys, Donovan West and Frias, they kind of popped out with their athleticism, especially Donovan West. He's quick, man. He's really quick. So very excited. And, yes, I can't wait to put the pads on to see how those guys really do respond and play real football.
How has the early signing period affected the
team's recruiting
process?
Man, it's I love it. And from the selfish side, it's because there's nothing worse than going through a football season, you work your butt off, and then you got a couple days off, you know, at Christmas, but you're really not off because you got to worry about your recruit going somewhere else. Even if he's committed, you're still recruiting. But it was just a breath of fresh air having those guys signed and just sitting back and just enjoying a couple days of life, you know. So I love that. I love the fact that when you go back out in January, you can now, you're way more concentrated on the 2020 class and the 2021 class and doing your homework. And now, instead of in the past where you would go out in the spring and locate guys, now it's backed it all up. Now we're locating them in December. Now you plan out and you know exactly where to go in the spring, if that makes sense. So I love it. I didn't know how I was going to like it, but I love it. Yes, sir.
Following up on that, sorry. If you want to obviously self-assess your own team after a season, when it's a more condensed amount of time to do that in January, does that factor in at all with the early starts of the spring ball?
Yeah, it was tough. It was really tough because I spent the nights in the hotel room watching cut-ups and getting prepared for spring practice when, you know, you kind of did that. You got back. You could breathe and all that stuff. But one thing that I like about what we're doing, I think is really awesome, is that most of the time you would have a month, I guess you would say, and you would work out with the strength and conditioning coach. Then you do spring practice. Then you get back going to the strength and conditioning coach. Now, man, they're going to have uninterrupted time with just a pure program with no stoppage. And I think that's going to be really helpful for our team and our kids. Good? Yes, sir.
Uh-huh. Aside from the wide receivers that we know, ones that have already kind of proven themselves, are there some other guys that are going to become backers here?
You know, Jordan Porter needs to be. You know, he needs to step up, and he has today. He improved. He got better from yesterday to today. And playing wide receiver, man, some people think it's easy that – and I would totally disagree with them on that. It's a process, man. And especially now you're facing press coverages and things like that, and you got to be strong. You can't just be, you know, weak and try to get off press. And so it's a process. And guys just can't line up and go out there and be great at receiver. Brandon Ayuk looks nothing like he did last year. You guys were out there today. I mean, he's a guy. You know what I'm saying? And we knew that. I mean, I knew that was going to happen, because, and I said that several times, because the junior college guys, it's a process, man. They get here, and they're just learning how to compete in a new environment, a new everything. He comes in, he's comfortable. He knows where his classes are. He knows his schedule. He knows what to do, and he just shows up, and he plays ball. And he's so much better right now, right? And Jordan, it's time for him to start getting towards getting towards that, and he's doing that, and he did that today. I was very proud of him. So, you know, Jordan Porter, Curtis Hodges, all right? These guys, they got to step up for us. They got to be playmakers for us, Jordan and Curtis Hodges. And just let me think, who am I, and we're going to rely on the freshmen coming in. You know, they're going to have to at least compete and come in and see if they can't do something for us, because we're going to need some guys. You're going to need to have number two wide receivers, right? Because when you play with tempo, you can't just play the same guy and he plays for, you know, 70, 80 snaps. That's impossible. We had 8 starters at Cal when I was there. We had 8 true starters, and they just rotated in and out, and that's why we were able to be pretty good there. So those are the two guys that said when they need to step it up.
Thank you.